Greetings, I am Herbert Erpaderp, and today is the day for the asking of the Herbert Erpaderp, which is me, Herbert Erpaderp. This is going to be a shorter one today. It's hot and I want to spend as little time as I can closed into this room. First question this week comes from Patreon. Questions from Patreon will always come first, even if it's traditional to answer Discord first. Earl Arndt, sorry if I've said that wrong, said, JTFM Enterprises makes a resin Lux and his models are a thing to behold. And there's a link which I've also pasted in the description if anybody else wants to check them out. Earl continues saying, I just received one but haven't put it together yet. I love the videos, keep up the good work. When I see things about wildlife in Australia, it seems like between the snakes, spiders, sharks, etc., that all the animals are there to kill people. Have you ever had an incident with a dangerous animal? This comment actually reminded me that I ordered something from JTFM Enterprises some time ago and it never arrived. Their models do look really good and I would like to pick up a few more, but not receiving the package makes me kind of hesitant. I have been in touch with them and they've said that they're going to resend that order, which is really good. I'm sure it's not a common occurrence, but shipping across the world is bound to have some issues from time to time. Has anybody else had any experiences, good or bad, with JTFM Enterprises or Die Waffenkammer, or however you say that, which is the name of their site? Let me know in the comments below. To answer the actual question, I've never had a real incident with a dangerous animal. I've come across snakes a few times and they've been quick to flee every time. If you leave them alone, they will generally leave you alone. I've seen things like stingrays and sharks in the aquarium, but not in the wild. I've seen jellyfish and bluebottles in the wild, but not been stupid enough to go swimming with them. I think in cities and suburban areas, dangerous animals aren't such a big issue. There's still snakes and spiders and stuff, of course, but it's not nearly as bad as people seem to perceive. We do have a lot of poisonous and venomous creatures, but it doesn't really help that Australians are generally all too happy to make out that everything is vicious and poisonous and out to get you. I mean, everything is dangerous and poisonous and out to kill you and everything you love. Now to Discord for the traditional KV2 turret related question. Ducking Tanker says, if you could build a KV2 turret, would you? Have you ever played a game called Imperion? It's a very fun game to play with friends. I've already built a KV2 turret, a few in fact, unless you mean a real one, which I haven't. I'm not sure I would like to build a real one. It sounds like hard work in a hot factory. This is the first time I've heard of Imperion. It looks like it's similar in concept to No Man's Sky. Might be worth checking out. I'm not sure it's something the usual group of friends I play games with would be particularly interested in. It looks to be a little bit slow-paced, but that's just a first glance, and I haven't really looked much into it. Smoze said, I'm looking at getting into bolt action. Can you explain what a theatre book is and what they do? And can you play with a tank and a couple of infantrymen, or is it strictly infantry or tank? Sorry for the long question. Hey, no need to worry, it wasn't that long a question and I really don't mind anyway. I don't know exactly what a theatre book is, I've never used one, but I figure it's something similar to an army book like Armies of the Soviet Union, for example. I think the difference is that a theatre book will focus more specifically on whichever theatre the book is about and units involved in the fighting there. They probably contain special rules and specific army lists and things like that. You don't need one to play, but it might enhance your experience, especially if you're into playing historically realistic battles. Maybe not, like I said, I've never used one. In bolt action, you can play an army pretty much however you like, really. You can play infantry only, or you can bring a tank or two with your infantry if your points limit allows. Or you can play tank wars and bring tanks only. There's a few options. And as long as your opponent agrees, you can house rule the lists however you like, too. Probably best to not mess around with house rules too much when you're starting out, though. The Big Boy said, what's, in your opinion, the worst model you recorded yourself building? Either this Warlord Resin Hetzer, or this Airfix Tiger 1. Both are pretty poor. I'm not sure which is worse. Those are the first two that come to mind. What do you guys think? What's the worst model I've built in a video? Speaking of Airfix and bad kits, the other week I put up a video about an Airfix Spitfire and it seems most of the comments include some variation of, it's bad and you should have got the kit with the new tooling. Like Rubsalot here who says a very good review for a pretty awful kit I'd say. I don't really think it was a very good review. I feel like I gave it a solid, it's okay, especially considering the price and manufacturer. Maybe I'm not so critical as a lot of people. I don't like to shit on things just because they're not perfect. Especially when expecting perfection is unreasonable. It usually is. To be honest, I didn't think it was that bad. It looks a lot like a Spitfire, though to be fair, I'm not a rivet counter and I don't really know a whole lot about planes, so maybe it doesn't. It looks alright to me though, not amazing obviously, and the gaps are pretty bad, but it's definitely fairly good compared to some of the other kits from Airfix that I've built, like that Tiger I showed before. Maybe comparing with other Airfix kits isn't the best measure of quality. I would love to buy the new tooling kits, but I have no idea which ones they are. I don't think I've ever not bought an Airfix kit as an impulse buy at the hobby shop. Pretty much all of my non-wargaming kits are impulse buys and I don't see that changing. It's all well and good to say buy the new tooling, but how does impulse buying Herbert know which ones they are? They're all in the same box because Airfix wants to sell the old tooling as well as the new. The pricing isn't really a reliable gauge. I've seen two of the same identical Airfix kit with different prices on them, and I do often see them with a discount. You could list kits that have the new tooling, but I'm probably not going to remember any of them, and I'm not going to stand in the hobby shop on my phone trawling through lists or forums or finding reviews. Nor am I likely to buy them online. Shopping online gives me time to stop and think, hey, I need to be more responsible with my money. I think the sensible solution is to not buy Airfix kits anymore. I mean, if they don't care to be clear in what they're selling, I can take my money elsewhere. I have heard people justify selling old kits from the 60s as a way to fund new tooling, but I don't think that's worth the risk and I really don't buy into it. My money is probably better spent on brands like Tamiya or Trumpeter anyway, so I think that's what I'll be doing. On last week's Ask a Herbert Erpaderp, Kieran Keith said, "Would you play a game called Firewatcher? It's quite good and you've probably heard it slash played it. And do you have any plans to build any Cromwell tanks or variants?" I'm pretty sure you mean Firewatch, but if there's a different game called Firewatcher, I've never heard of it. I haven't played Firewatch, nor do I own it, but it has been on my to-buy list for some time. I saw someone over at Loading Ready Run stream it and it looked pretty decent. I think it might be worth at least giving it a play and maybe even streaming it myself. I'm not sure if I'll do that yet, but your comment has brought the game back to my mind. I don't have any immediate plans for more Cromwells, though I do kind of want one in 1/35th scale. I have actually put together a few of them including a Flames of War recovery version and I've even painted them in both 15 and 28mm scales. If you look through my older videos, you should easily be able to find the ones about Cromwells. Cromwells are amongst my favourite tanks, so there will definitely be more of them at some point. Haha Lol said, "If you didn't throw the Art of Tactic flags away, you could make them into flagpoles." I'm not entirely sure what this is in relation to. I'm super forgetful. At any rate, you're absolutely right, and I have kept them. I think they might make for some cool tokens or objective markers or something like that, and it would only take a tiny bit of work to do. I mean, they're already flags on poles, so there's not really a lot to do to them. Top Bunk Productions said, "How did you manage to grow that magnificent beard of yours? I'm trying to grow one of my own, but it just looks like a thin mess at the moment." The trick is to not shave. I don't really have a better answer than that. I always wanted to have a big ZZ Top beard when I was younger. It wasn't until I was around 25 or so that I was able to grow a proper full beard without some degree of patchiness. I'm also kind of hairy, which obviously helps, so I've always been able to grow some decent facial hair, like a goatee or big sideburns. Well, not always, but you get what I mean. I guess there isn't really a secret, it's just a combination of not shaving and genetics. Some might say good or bad ones depending on their opinions on facial hair. Maybe you could opt for non-full beard facial hair that works with whatever patchiness you have. I don't know, keep trying. I don't know how old you are, but if you're younger, it might just be a matter of patience. Maybe listening to the beards will help. Do that. And that's it for this week. Time for me to go out and do Herbert things. If you have a question you would like me to answer, put it in the comment section below, or in any of the other places I'm likely to see it, like Patreon, Discord, or the Tweety. And if you want, you can subscribe to me here on YouTube, follow me on social media, or watch me stream on Twitch. I do recommend doing all of those things, because why not? If you really like the things I do, please consider helping to support the channel over at patreon.com/herbertherpaderp. That would be excellent. Check the links in the description for further information. I shall return soon, so until then, happy whatever it is you're doing, and thanks for watching. Farewell.